Hey, pottery pals. I thought I would show you a video today of how I do a biscuit fire, or bisque firing, as they like to term it properly. What that is basically, if you don't know, where you take greenware, and that is basically clay that has dried completely, like all of these urns I'm getting ready to do. Clay that's dried completely, and we're talking completely, no moisture whatsoever. You can usually test that by holding it to your face to see if it's still cool. Now, it's like 62 degrees in here, so it's cool. everything is cool. But I can tell by experience that there's no moisture left in this in these pots. And we're going to do something about that anyway. We will do what we call candling, which means we will put it in a kiln basically at, you know, turkey baking temperatures, or less, actually, that below the boiling point, 210 degrees. We'll leave it there for about 2 hours. That'll drive all the residual moisture out of the pots. And then the ramp schedule, which is digital, which I have a digital controller here that goes all the way to my Frankenstein control system that controls these kilns. And we'll control it that way. But let's get started right after this. Dummy. One of the things I like to do before I actually, you know, convert my greenware into ceramic, bisque fire it, is I like to go into all of my pots and make sure there aren't any residual little flakes or pieces of clay clinging to the insides of them, because if you fire them, you're going to get this thing that won't come out. I do a little prep work, clean the pieces off, possibly sand them just slightly if they're not fitting properly. You know, a little preparation. So what I typically do on these urns is I look, and if you look, there's a little weird piece there. There's some pieces hanging out inside this lid. I'll clean those off carefully. I'll check the rim, make sure it's fairly decent. And if you look, you can see down in there, there's all these chunks for where I trimmed the pot. Now, most of the time those will come out, but I like to take a very soft brush, and I'll go down into it, and I will actually brush those out. It's hard to do this with one hand, obviously. I'm holding the camera. But I brush those all out so that they're loose. And once you're sure that they're all loose, edges too, all the way around, once you're sure that those are all loose, you can just leave them in there. They'll actually just, you know, you just shake the pot and they'll fall out after the bisque fire. But, you know, making sure everything is all right in preparation. Now that I have all of the pieces cleaned and tidied up, I'm going to load them into the kiln, my big one, of course. I've got them all out of the way here, and I'm going to be placing them in Papa Bear here to make sure I have enough room. Let's see if I can open Papa Bear with the camera in hand. It supports itself. I'll have to get larger posts, but just hang on just a second. Let's see where I landed here in the ceiling. Because this is a small room. This is my coal room in my house. This is concrete. It runs almost the entire perimeter of the room, so it makes it handy to defend against the temperature of the kilns, and the entire surface of the room has been covered with insulation, high temperature insulation, so yeah, get away with some of it. Plus, we have a main ventilation fan. So let's, I also have kiln vents attached to these two, Mama Bear and Papa Bear. So what I'm going to do is switch out these kiln posts with the really tall ones. That should be about right now. Something like that is going to get close, but as you can see, it's not quite there, so I'll actually have to add somebody else to the top of that one. Now, people say, well, why don't you just fire them without the lids on it? You can, especially with Raku clay, but there's a chance that this could warp and change dimensions with this. If that's the case, the lid will no longer fit after it's biscuit fired, or glaze fired for that matter. If I was stoneware firing these are all going to be Raku, most of them, except for the skulls, of course. But yeah, that's that problem. So as you can see, this one's going to be a problem even with that. And this one's going to be a problem even with that. So that's some of the logistics that you, or, you know, little problems that you get trying to load a kiln. You have to kind of pre-think it beforehand, because yeah, all of these guys hopefully are going to go in there, and there's a lot of mass there, so we'll see how well we do. I'll stop and start the camera periodically to show you how my procedure is going. Okay, we've got some of them squirreled away. As you can see, I've got some of the more smaller pieces, like the skulls, tucked away inside of little crevices. That one's way back in the corner. These are fairly tall, but they're not enormously tall. So what I found I'm going to have to do is leave an open area for these two really tall pieces, and maybe another one right up on here, and put one shelf here, and then stack the rest of them, hopefully, on top of that shelf. Let's see how that works. Well, that didn't work. This is why we do this. I had to end up putting my post back in, because I still have, you know, a lot of urns that aren't going to fit in here. So I'll have to come up with another idea for the tall ones, but yeah, that's about what I'm going to be able to do for the bottom layer. Now for the top layer. Well, I finally got it. So here's the... I actually got enough room to put the lids on them, which I like. So we will proceed with our firing in just a moment.
Go ahead and release this.
Ready to go. Now to turn on the system. Then this needs to come off. Oh. I got the controller ready. This kiln setter is tripped. I have the correct thermocouple in to make sure. So what we want to do is we want to recall a program, my number one, and enter that. So now it's set for the bisque fire. What I'm going to do is review that program. Segments 5. First ramp goes to 300 degrees until it gets to 210, and it holds that for an hour and a half. And then it goes to 300 degrees until it gets to 950. And then it limps over that at 105 degrees until it gets to 1100 degrees. And then it goes from 1100 to 250 degrees an hour until it gets to 1800 degrees. And then it goes from 1800 degrees at 100 degrees an hour to 1945, holds that for 5 minutes, and then ends. Gives me my firing, and so we're idle again, so all I have to do is hit start. It says on. You should see that kick. It just did. It was a little bit too fast for me. Wait for it again. You should see this kick right here. There it goes. So now I need to plug up all my peepholes. Whatever you do. Don't forget your kiln god. Very important.
And then we're done. That's how I do a bisque firing.
This firing will be done in about a little over 10 hours. So it's actually quite fast. I typically should candle more than an hour and a half. But in order to get to 240 degrees, it takes about 30 minutes of firing. So it's about a 2 hour candle. So yeah, that should work. I'll show them to you when we're done. Okay, so the firing's over, and let's take a look at what happened inside the bisque kiln.
Here's the controller. I actually hit stop before I realized I was supposed to videotape more. This was set at about 10 hours and 15 minutes. So that's how long the firing took. So now it's at 212 degrees, easily openable. Turn the fan off. I'll go ahead and shut off the main system. I don't see anybody broken. Here, I'm gonna put you guys down for a second. Do this the proper way. There. Now nobody can get hurt. Okay. Yeah, no cracks. We're all good. So, we'll get our little kiln guy out of the way here. These are like oven gloves. They can't take a high amount of temperature, but they can take... hard to do with one hand. They can take quite a bit of temperature, so... they're good for unloading kilns. Love that sound. Think it's been on that? Yeah, it did. Okay, I'm going to turn you guys off, and the next time I turn you on, I'll have these shelves removed. We'll see what everything looks like. But it looks like a pretty successful bisque firing. These look okay too. I removed that one. So what I'm looking for is the dreaded pop out. And what a pop out is if obviously you burnish or smooth out something like Raku clay, which has just an inordinate amount of grog in it. So it can take the thermal shock of, you know, either quenching it or doing whatever you're gonna do quickly in Raku. Some of the grog has little pieces of metal or just foreign bodies in it, and sometimes it'll literally make a crater pop out in the firing. Usually disc firing, because this is about as hard as this clay is going to get at cone 04, obviously just below the 2000 degree mark in 1940-ish. That temperature is as far as the ceramic is actually going to center. And that's as hard as that piece is going to get, because when I apply Raku glaze to it and take it outside and do the Raku process with it, can you see me? That only goes up to about 1800 degrees, and it does it relatively quickly, like in about 30 minutes. So you're not going to affect the clay body anymore by doing that. In fact, you're probably going to damage it by putting a lot of stresses on it, because you're going to melt glass, very low temperatured glass as far as Raku glaze is concerned over the surface of it, and put stresses on the clay body itself. So high grog clay, heavy, it's like the army tank of ceramic clays. So yeah, this looks pretty good. Of course, this is going to be stoneware. Just one of my. And there's usually pieces left inside, because, like I said, I use the brush to clean off
the residual pieces on the inside. I just leave them in there to fire, because it's not going to hurt anybody. Although he looks like he might hurt somebody. Curse them. I saw a lot of those. It's kind of hot down here. This one, I was very happy that Ruth decided to do another dogwood piece. She'll do cherry blossoms, these are dogwoods. And she'll go in here and literally paint each one of these out. I may show that to you when it's done. Yes, lots of dragonfly urns. That's for an order. Here's one for a show. I just thought he'd be cool to sit down in there because it's got the wolf seal on it. If you can see that, it'd be very difficult. But that gets stained. And see? Residuals. But no big deal. I'm running out of room. All I have left is a skull, so.
There we go.
Unloaded. And there's a widow's son that I need to make good on, because that one leaked. So I get to keep it. Thanks for watching. More later.